Welcome. It's nice to see all the seats filled up. I know that this is always one of our most important lectures, and one of the lectures that allows us the privilege of being able to match how we feel with what we think. And we are most privileged to have two people come to speak with us. I'm sure you could see that we know each other and care about each other. Our speakers today are Lucille Eichengreen. You know Lucille because you've read her book. I'm sure she might, at the end of today's lecture, I'm sure that she would be willing to sign it for you. Right? Am I presuming something? Yeah. Okay. One of the other things that I would like to announce is that I've gotten several emails from students who are interested in the Human Rights Club. The Human Rights Club sprang out of the lecture series last year, and students, as I've mentioned to all of you, I think, have been very active in the cause of genocide awareness. And if you are, we're going to pass this around, if you are interested in information or joining the Human Rights Club, if you'll put your name and your email and perhaps a phone number, they'll be able to contact you. Oh. Barbara's reminded me to tell you, or to ask you, to plead with you, to please turn your cell phones off.
And your beepers and pagers and other things that make interesting noises.
Right. Right. Okay. There is one, is it warm? Are you warm? No. I can see you. So hands waving, it draws my attention. Our first speaker is Lucille Eichengreen. Normally I introduce our speakers by giving a short biography of them, but she has already done that in the book that you're going to read. Without further ado, I welcome you to welcome Lucille Eichengreen. Lucille.
The word genocide to me had been unknown. And had I known the word, I had hoped that after the Holocaust, this would not be repeated. If you look at the world today, at Africa, at the former Yugoslavia, genocide exists, and they have their own version of a German Holocaust. I cannot really address the topic of genocide. I can only tell you of the 12 years of the Hitler government in Germany, which ultimately ended in the Holocaust and in the destruction of more than 6 million Jewish human beings, more than 1 million imprisoned non-Jewish human beings. And I'm asking myself, why? To what end? Why was this possible? And why did the world stand by, including the United States, and do nothing about it? So far, I have not found an answer. I was 8 years old when Hitler came to power in Germany. I went to a private Jewish school, and the first I noticed is that the children that normally spoke to us, walked with us, avoided us. Avoiding was not enough. They began to throw stones, to spit at us, and to be very ugly, beat us up. They no longer saw us or wanted to see us, They wore a uniform, even though they did not have to when they went to school. They wore brown pants or brown skirts, a white shirt, and a brown tie. They were members of the Hitler Youth. How it came to pass in so short a time is not to be explained. How a population of a country can turn so fast between January 1933 and, for instance, March 33, when my husband was the first time arrested, to summer of 33, when we were told, last but not least, Hitler will take care of the Jews. We were Polish nationals living in Germany at the time, but that really didn't make much difference. We had the protection of an embassy, of a consulate, but their form of anti-Semitism existed in a different form, but it was evident. The school years which I spent in the Jewish school in Hamburg, Germany, had nothing but Jewish students and a Jewish faculty. It was a very strict school. It was probably, looking back, a thorough education, but not what you would call today a good education. It was full of prejudice on the other side. It was narrow-minded. For instance, I was not allowed to enter a church. When somebody asked me, come with me to church or look at the church, my father and the teachers at school would say, you don't enter a church. I would have never said such a thing to my children, but I grew up with prejudices against me and against other people. Life continued more or less in this vein, with the exception that state employees, such as teachers, professors at universities, lawyers, judges, were no longer allowed to practice. It even was extended as far as to Jewish doctors who were marked, and they were avoided to a large extent. On November 10th, 1938, my sister was 5 years younger and I walked to school. We saw broken glass, empty showcase windows. We couldn't understand what had happened. We came to the large synagogue, which was not far from the school, in a very occupied area. The synagogue was burning, the roof was missing, and around the synagogue were SR and SS in full uniform laughing. They were burning the books which they had found inside, some written in German, some in Hebrew, and they were burning them. Now it reminds me of a quote which Heinrich Heine, a German poet, had made 200 years prior to this incident. He said, when they will burn books, it won't be long until they burn human beings. But while many people had read this quotation, including my parents, nobody took it seriously. On the same day, all the men between the ages of 16 and 65 were arrested. They were taken to a concentration camp near Berlin, and they were released within the following 6 months, slowly, and they all came back with missing front teeth, shorn heads, and their suits were terribly wrinkled. They had been put through a machine which was to disinfect these garments, and you could not remove the creases ever, not with an iron, not by any other means. These men did not talk of what had happened to them. Most of them emigrated in short order, some to Shanghai, some to South America, a few to the United States, and the families, if they were lucky, followed. We had to vacate our home, our apartment. The Germans invented so-called Jewish houses, which meant we had to move into a house that at one point or another had been owned by a Jewish family, but now it was state property. Our bank accounts were confiscated. We received $100 or the equivalent, $100 a month, and it was not possible to live on that kind of money. The Germans slowly started a war against the Jews. We could not use a park bench. It says Jews not allowed. We couldn't go to the symphony or to the opera. We were standing in the back of a streetcar because we were not supposed to sit down. And we were warned by our teachers to be very quiet. And it seemed to us that we had to be invisible, which a child cannot understand. When I asked my parents why this change and why aren't we leaving, the answer was pretty uniform. It's only temporary and it will change, but they couldn't tell me when. On September 1st, 1939, the German army invaded Poland. And in very short order, it was between 1 week and until all resistance ceased, 4 weeks, Poland was occupied by the Germans. My father was arrested as a Polish national. He was treated in accordance with the Geneva Convention until Poland was declared fully occupied. Then he was sent to a concentration camp in Berlin and from Berlin to Dachau. We heard very seldom from him. We tried to get papers for immigration, but it was very difficult. There were many, many thousands of people in Europe that tried to leave the country, and we did not succeed in getting the papers. My father was murdered in Dachau on January 31st, 1941. We did not hear about it until a few days later when the Gestapo came to the furnished room in which we lived now, my mother, sister, and I, and threw a cigar box on the table with the words, "Ashes, Benjamin Landau." The grave still exists in the Jewish cemetery in Hamburg, but I doubt very much whether the ashes, in fact, were my father's ashes. We were ordered shortly thereafter to wear a yellow star, and we were instantly recognized on the street, which meant we were called names, people were throwing stones, and the curfew was from dark in the evening till early morning. Once my mother and I went out at night, and it was shortly before the death of my father. Someone had been released from Dachau and was leaving for Italy, and we wanted to speak to him. As we walked in the dark streets, and Germany was totally dark, because they were on war footing, no street lights. We heard steps and lights, saw lights behind us. My mother ran to the right, I ran to the left. I ended in the gutter, and the footsteps stepped over me and disappeared in the distance. I had a broken foot, which I did not know. We continued to see the man who had come out of Dachau. He used to be tall and blonde and heavy set. He was skinny, he had no hair, and he had no teeth. The only thing he told us, don't worry, Benno is okay. He did not tell us anything else. We hoped. We got a letter, I am fine, with a signature, once every 6 or 8 months, otherwise nothing else. In October 1941, we received a notice from the Gestapo to pack one small suitcase and to report at a school not far from the railway station. There were 1,150 human beings, men, women, and children. We were put into trains. The trains were sealed from the outside. And when we arrived 3 days later, we were in Poland. We were handed over to people who were called the ghetto police, and we were in the city of Lodz in central Poland. Walking the 2 hours from the train into the city was a tremendous shock. It was the poorest, the most run-down section of a large industrial city. We saw pumps in the yards, which should have indicated to us that there was no running water. There was sewage running along the sidewalks to the streets, and we were put into a small room, 8 people, with just 3 wooden cots and a small stove. October went into November and December. It got very, very cold. We did not have the right clothing. I remember I had 2 light coats and I wore outside 2 coats, one on top of the other. The room had no water. It had to be carried up 3 flights of stairs in a bucket, and there was a bucket for salt water. And the clean water froze overnight. It was that cold inside. The windows were covered with frost, and we were very close to the barbed wire. The ghetto was surrounded by German guards, by barbed wire, and there was no into the ghetto, no out of the ghetto. No information came into that ghetto that housed anywhere from 70,000 to 160,000 human beings. We did not know whether the Russian front existed. We did not know whether France was occupied or not. We had no idea. There was one radio, and it didn't work very well. And nobody addressed our situation. The ghetto was governed by a Jewish council and by a head of the Jewish community. His motto was, our only way is work. We were sewing the uniforms for the German army. We made their boots. We were making hats for the ladies in Germany, furniture for the children in Germany. And the promise was we would not get paid because there was no money in the ghetto. There was ghetto money printed, which was worthless, but we would get food. Food we did not get. Sometimes we got turnips. We got a loaf of bread, which had to last in the beginning 7 days, at the end 14 days. The cemetery near the ghetto has 70,000 bodies buried. And occasionally the Germans would decide that the ghetto was overcrowded and they would have a forced deportation. The first deportation that I witnessed was May 1942. They took about 20,000 people out of the ghetto, mainly the old and the ones not able to work. The ones that had come from Berlin, from Prague, from Vienna, from other places, and they disappeared. We never heard from them again. and there was no way of finding out where they had been sent. We were told probably to another camp. My mother died of hunger in 1942 on July 13th, and a week later my sister and I buried her because there was nobody at the cemetery to bury the many dead. The Germans again decided that the ghetto was too crowded, and they demanded 20,000 human beings, most of them teenagers and children. The Jewish head of the ghetto made a speech, "Hand over your children so that the rest of us may live." I have never forgiven him those words. Parents did not turn over their children, and the Germans had a curfew for the ghetto for 7 days and nights. They came into the ghetto house by house. They took the children, they took the old, they took the sick, they emptied the hospital, and they deported more than 20,000 human beings, my sister among them. We never heard from them again. After the war, I wrote to Poland and I received an official letter back that the children of this deportation were taken to Auschwitz and killed. Many years later, it was corrected. All these transports were taken to Chelmo, an hour away from the ghetto. The people were gassed and burned in mass graves. The mass graves are still in existence today. I took the trip. Life in the ghetto got worse. Food got less. And there was very little hope left. There were people like my boss, who was the chief of the statistical department, Oskar Singer, who claimed the war would be over in a few weeks. Well, it wasn't over. The Germans decided in August 1944 to liquidate the Lodz ghetto. It was the one ghetto that was in existence the longest in Poland. 800 of the 70,000 people that inhabited the ghetto managed to hide. And not all of them, but most of them survived, the 800, until the Russian army approached. The rest of us were shipped in cattle cars to Auschwitz. They took all our belongings, all our papers, shaved our hair. The old ones were sent to the gas chambers, the older ones. The younger ones were shipped further after a few weeks. And I was shipped to a camp not far from Hamburg. And we were 500 women to clean up the bomb damage that the English and the Americans had inflicted during the past 3 years. It was hard labor under SS guard. Some of us died, some of us were shot, and at the end we were sent to Bergen-Belsen. In Bergen-Belsen we knew that there was no surviving. It was a camp that was totally diseased with typhoid. The dead were lying on the walkways in open graves. There was no food anymore, and we knew our days were numbered. You probably know that Anne Frank died there in January of 1945 of typhus. The British stumbled upon the camp on the way to the Elbe River to cut off the Russian army. They had no idea we existed. They tried to help with medication, with food, but all of that took some time. You couldn't do it overnight. They found more than 10,000 dead, and another 10,000 died while they occupied the camp. They eventually burned the camp and housed us in the German army former German army housing. I worked for the British as an interpreter and translator. I helped them arrest 42 SS, whose name I happen to remember. I got threats that I would be killed from their families, and they drove me to Holland, to Belgium, and then to Paris, where I received my papers for the United States. I arrived in New York on March 21st, 1946, after having lived in Paris, and Paris had ration cards, was recovering from a war. I lived in a dormitory, and it was not easy. I met my husband in New York later that year. We got married. We moved to California. My kids were born in California. They still live in California. And I've been back several times during the last 8 years. I was back there 2 years ago with the BBC. You might have seen the film Auschwitz. I was back there for the 60th anniversary last May of the end of the war. And it's a difficult trip. It's not easy. I must admit, I can neither forget nor forgive. If my children can do so, that is up to them. I cannot. I have two young friends in Germany. They're historians. Otherwise, I'm being treated politely, but not like a human being. I'm being treated like something that is not clean or not hadn't taken a shower for a week. I don't feel at ease. People might be trying, and today's generation is not at fault. But they claim that their grandfathers tell a different story than I tell. And of course, they believe their grandfather and not me. They're building monuments. They build museums, mainly in Berlin. All the former concentration camps have now a memorial. But I'm asking myself, have they learned from the past? Have we learned from the past? No. We haven't. The world is a mess. And I hope that young people like you will make a difference, because my generation didn't make a difference. I will answer questions afterwards. Thank you.
And I'm a Holocaust survivor. And after listening to Lucia here, I came in at the end. Otherwise, I was born in Czechoslovakia, and my country was occupied, my part of Czechoslovakia was occupied in 1938. After they went through already a lot of problems we didn't even know about. Our house didn't have a radio, we had no electricity, so we couldn't hear the news. The Hungarians occupied us in 1938, and as soon as they came in, they started to make our lives miserable. They took away the Jewish licenses from Jewish proprietors, stores or shops, and put in, and we couldn't operate. They couldn't operate, and they, most of us didn't have what to eat after a while. But they put in non-Jewish people, managers, to manage our businesses, the Jewish businesses. And on top of it, the Jewish proprietor had to stay there and teach them. teach them how to manage the store. And when they thought that they knew enough, then they kicked them out and they just took over everything legally. Now, this was, as I said, in 1938. They picked up all the young people, the young men, and I think they from 16 to about 45, the able-bodied men were all called in, and they established a working camp, a forced labor camp. Because before these kids were taken to become soldiers, about when they are 19, but now the Jewish kids were all, the Jewish men were all in the labor camp, forced labor camp all over the territory. And they had to dig ditches and build roads and work in mines and whatever was needed, any dirty work, they were forced to do without any compensation. Every now and then, they let somebody out, somebody home, and they came and they told us what was happening on the borders, on the Polish borders, how the Jews were being killed, how the big machines came and dug the big hole, and the Jews had to stand around it and strip, and then they were machine gunned into that hole. And you know, it was Poland. I thought it was a world away from Czechoslovakia, which is not, but I was 14 years old at the time, and somehow I didn't feel it. I didn't think it's gonna come to us. But day after day, something new came up. Like our friends turned to informers, and they came over, they went to the Nazis and the Hungarians, and they were telling them about that this was doing this was listening to a radio, this said something against the regime. And they made up things. And the limousines, the black limousines stopped very frequently on the street with a SS. And they just picked up these young people for two kids were talking or something. There was a reason for them to pick them up and throw them in the limousine, the Gestapo, and took them in, and we never heard from them. And if once in a while somebody came out, then they were so tortured and they were so beaten up that I think they just let them out so that they would intimidate and scare the rest of us. 38, about 40, we just, a lot of things were happening to me and to my family then. The Hungarians were almost as bad and worse in some cases than the Nazis. They kept little by little, took everything away from us, material things, and no young people were left at home, except the handicapped and the old men and the children. And this was, they were dragging it out. We had no teenage life at all, and if we tried to go someplace, people that were our friends before, they stood up on a box and said, "Jews out." So we went out, and we never went back again. As the years went by, they were talking about rumors that we are going to be relocated. Nothing positive was told, we were not told anything positively, when, what, why, but we are going to be relocated to work in a farm. Meantime, the Czechs were taken away, because Czechoslovakia was established from different parts of the neighboring countries, Poland, Hungary, Romania, and and Slovakia, and that's how Czechoslovakia came into existence. And then all these places were were taken back when the Hungarians came. They took our part, and they took other part. The other countries took other parts, and there was no more Czechoslovakia. In 1944, see, we were still lucky, because as bad as it was, we didn't have hardly anything to eat. We still could go to school, and we still were together, the families, until 1944. There was no place to go for us, because all the countries around us were already occupied by Hitler. And if the boys, some of the young boys, tried to cross the border to Russia, and the news came that they were shot at the border as spies. So we couldn't do anything. So then one day we were contacted, and they said, now everyone take from the house as much as you can carry in your hands, and come out, and we let you know where you're gonna meet. And 2 days later, we had all the signs posted that every Jewish person had to line up at a certain place, and just come out, and they're gonna take us someplace. When I came out, on the morning that we were supposed to be assembled, I saw all these old people with teary eyes, scared, bewildered, not knowing what to expect, and children crying with runny noses. It was cold, and I was looking at it, and I was questioning, why? What did we do? Our only crime was being born Jews. And they put us through that kind of a torture and that kind of misery. When they had enough, when all of us were out already, then they lined us up 5 to a row, and we had to march. Every third five row, there was a guard with a machine gun. They were guarding us. There was no place to go. We couldn't even go, because we were afraid if one goes, then they're going to kill the family. So we were just listening and obeying and going through the city. And I couldn't figure out where they're taking us. And when we came to the end of the town, of the city, they told us to stop. And there was the brick factory on a huge piece of land, and they had these shelves, huge shelves, about 3 layers, where they were placing the bricks to dry or to cool after they took it out of the kiln. Only this time, there were no bricks there. I looked up there, and I saw a bunch of people there. It looked like a zoo. There was straw underneath, and men, women, and children, whoever, from the surrounding vicinity, were brought in, and those shells were filled by them, with them. When we came there, there was no place for us, and some boys that were there came over and says, "Come on, let's pick up some scraps, and let's build you some shelter." And so we went to picked up broken bricks, we picked up some cardboard, some pieces of wood, whatever we could find. And then we came back to the spot where I left my family. And I don't know how, but somehow a shelter was put together. Where it was, the top was covered with blankets, the sides were covered with blankets, and underneath we could sleep, six of us. And we had, we whatever we brought, and the days went by, it was running out. We were running out of food. And my mom was very depressed. And then she used to be the leader in our family, always in control. And this time I was seeing she just couldn't function. And she says, as long as you are with me, I'm okay. Once any one of you will be taken from me, I'm as good as dead. And she kept saying that quite often. And we were in that place that they called the ghetto, in that brick factory, for 6 weeks. It was raining. It was cold. We didn't have what to eat anymore. And one day, some soldiers came and said, and just went like this, a group, and then they went to another group and picked up this many. He says, tomorrow you guys get ready, because you are being moved. Where are we going? Well, you're being taken to work. Okay. That was all that they told us. And by now we didn't believe them, but we didn't know what to believe. And to make it easier on us, we just went along. And my dad was injured in World War I, and his leg was hurting him, and he couldn't walk too fast. So he had a cane, when we lined up, I was holding on to him so he wouldn't fall. And there was this young Hitlerjugend with a whip and hitting everybody if they didn't move fast enough. And as they were chasing us like this, I tried to walk as fast as I could with my dad. My mom walked with my other sisters, and I don't know where they were taking us. It was raining. It was muddy. It was gray, and we came to the railroad station. When I looked up there, I saw a long line of the boxcars that. I knew that they used to transport animals in those cars. I couldn't figure out why were they there. As far as I could see, there were boxcars on each side. Then I found out soon, because they started to shout, now you go in. Every car was open. Now you go in, and started to push us and hit us to go into the boxcars. And I helped my dad, and it was hard, and we went in. And now by the time I got in with dad, there were so many of us that I thought this was it. But no, they kept on shoving more people. And they made us take our little belongings, the few belongings that we had. And finally, we were so full that we could hardly stand next to each other. Then they started on the other wagons, and when all the wagons were filled, then they closed the gates. They didn't give us water, they didn't give us food, we didn't have no toilet facilities, but I heard the gates closed, and then in a little while I heard the movement of the wheels and the screeching of the wheels, and I knew we were on the way. There were some slits between the boards in that car. And I went close to it, and I was peeking out, so I would get an idea where we are. But the train started to roll so fast that it was impossible to notice anything until we stopped. We stopped to taking up water or wood or whatever made the train go. And I looked out and at the station, and I saw the people that were manning the station. They were Polish. Most of them were happy with a big smile on their face and making this kind of a things that they know where we're going. We didn't, and they did. And We were just standing there and looking on and doing, couldn't do anything. Well, very soon we needed to go to the bathroom. Somebody donated a bucket, and somebody else donated a couple of blankets, and two people who were holding the blankets so that it would give a little privacy to the person that had to eliminate. That didn't last very long before it got filled up, and the stench was terrible, and some people were trying to throw it out from through those slits, but the train was going so fast that the wind blew it back in. So they just left it there, and it was overrunning and overrunning, and somehow it went out between on the floor, through the floor. And slowly, we were starving already. And we are one night, two nights, three nights. Sometimes the fourth day, the train came to a stop. But before we stopped, when we stopped someplace at another station, and I looked out, and I saw Polish people, and they were crying. The eyes were full of compassion and full of tears, those workers. So they knew also where we were being taken, but they were a different people, and they had some compassion. When all of a sudden I hear a baby cry, scream, not in our wagon, but maybe three wagons down, and the mother is shouting out, "Please give a little water to my baby, he's so sick. Give me a little water." And then I hear a terrible voice shouting, "Keep that bread quiet, no water." And you couldn't keep the bread quiet because the child was sick. So I heard some shots, a couple of shots and screams, and then it was quiet. Well, I could only make it out that somebody was killed. But we were going on, and then we arrived someplace, and we stopped. The train stopped. And they opened the gates, and we could hardly see because it was so dark in those wagons. And they opened the gates, and I heard a lot of ugly shoutings on the bullhorn and shoving and shouting, "Get out, without any packages, everybody out, without any packages," in German. My dad had a small briefcase where he kept his praying object, his talit, his phylacteries, and a prayer book. And when I helped him come off the train, he reached back for that. And at that moment, the SS was there already with a rifle butt turned and hearing him over his head and hearing him over and over until he was covered with blood and fell to the ground dead. Then he just motioned to some other halflings, and they had to pull my dad by his feet to a truck. And if I think about it, how his head was up and down, bloody head up and down, they're pulling him toward that truck. And I started to cry and said to the SS in German, "You just killed my father, why?" And he says, "You want to go with him?" And he's lifting up his rifle butt. So at that point, I ran away. I ran away to the group. Ran away from the SS, and I went to find my mother and my sisters. And of that, I have a picture here, or there, or somewhere. So later, if you want to, you can look at it. That was the big shock and big pain. And I was so busy with this that I didn't even notice when they separated the men from the women. And here I am coming to look for my mother, one sister, and here is one sister, something here and here. So this came from the Holocaust Museum from Washington, D.C. When I got it, I recognized it. I recognized ourselves, and I'm keeping it. So when we started, they lined us up five to a row, and we were moving forward. My mom was on this side, and she starts to scream, "They are taking you away from me. They're separating us. I'm as good as dead already." And that's all I heard. And I had a sister who was pretty tall for her age, and I said, "Renee, pull yourself down a little bit so you would stay with mom." Because then I saw too that the teenagers sort of were taken to one side, and the older and young people were taken to the other side. And I told her to pull herself down and go with mom. So they took her with mom and my baby sister and my one sister and myself to the other side. And I just turned around wanting to say goodbye to them or say that everything's going to be all right, because the rumor was started that on the weekends we get together and we see each other. And I wanted to say something to my family, and I looked back and they weren't there anymore. They were shoved very fast around the corner so that we wouldn't see each other. So I didn't even have a chance to say goodbye to my family. And that's the last time I've seen them. Now we were walking. I don't know. I couldn't believe what was happening. It didn't penetrate. I didn't know what to expect. I saw they took everything away from us. They took my parents away. They killed my father. They took away my mother with my two younger sisters. And one sister was with me and me walking. And I see a great building in the distance. And the pushing, shoving, and calling us ugly names by the SS was going on and on and on until it just made you crazy. So we come closer to that building until I could see that only five people are let in at one time, and there were some steps to go up. And I see five people going up, but I didn't see any place people coming out. So when our turn came, we went up the steps, and we came into this big hall, big building, big hall, and I looked down on the floor, and there I saw maybe tons of hair on the floor in all different colors, shades. I couldn't figure out where it came from, but I didn't have to wonder too long, because there were about five SS men standing there laughing and hollering, "Take everything off, take everything off." And I was waiting. I'm not going to undress in front of the men. So I was waiting for them to leave, which they didn't. And then their helpers, there were some girls that were there already, like the Polish girls were there already for many years in that camp. And now they were helping the Germans. They had to help the Germans. So they came and grabbed me by my coat and pulled it off of me, pulled my clothes off of me until I was naked. And then she pushed me into a chair. And then she came with a shaver and started to shave my head. And then I started to cry. "What are you doing?" "Shh, be quiet, be quiet, be quiet." And they shaved my head, and I'm standing there naked, shaved all the hair of my body too. And they gave me a piece of soap they called it soap, it was like a rock, and said, "Now go into that other room, the next room." I came in there, and my sister followed me, and we looked at each other, and we started to cry. We didn't see ourselves. But when we looked at each other, we could imagine how we looked. So I have to have a little water, please. Excuse me. As I looked up at the ceiling, there were shower heads on the ceiling. And pretty soon the water came down, cold water. But it felt good after all those days in the boxcars. So we washed as good as we could. They let us keep our shoes and nothing else. After that, after the shower was over, they turned off the water. At that point, we didn't know how lucky we were, because we were getting the water, whereas our families were getting, instead of in the same room, instead of the water, they were getting the gas, and they were killed. They pushed us outside, naked, no towels, naked, wet. And like I said a few times, it was cold, because I was shivering, I was cold to the bones. Ever since, I'm still cold. We were standing there for a couple hours, and they kept on coming to count us. They were counting us and counting us. We were all there, but because we couldn't get anywhere else. And it was, we were surrounded. And when I looked down and I saw the male prisoners coming up, and I just thought, God, I wish I was invisible, because I was naked. We were all naked. So after I don't know how long, they told us to come. Now we're gonna get some clothes. So they're taking us through some places, and we went to a room. And while we're walking by, I see big tables loaded with, one was loaded with children's shoes, one was loaded with all kinds of eyeglasses, and women were standing there and sorting them out. But the third one was loaded with dentures, and that was the most puzzling to me. But how will the old people eat if the dentures are taken from them? If they would tell me then that they were all killed, maybe I wouldn't even believe it. But you see, we were dressed, they gave me a small, very short skirt and a short sleeve blouse. No underwear, no stockings, nothing. Then they lined us up again, and they were taking us someplace. We came and we saw a barrack. It was pushed open by a bunch of women, and they jumped out, they ran out, they had long hair, they had nice street clothes, and they hollered at us, go back, go back. You came here to take our places. We couldn't go back, and we weren't taking their places, but that's what they shouted, and then I heard the guards pushing them back and shouting, Verfluchte Zigeuners. Then I knew that they were the gypsies. But until then, I didn't know that gypsies were brought to Auschwitz, too. We were taken to another barrack. There was a courtyard there, and we were all standing there and shivering. And we saw some, like a garbage can full of some mush in front of the door, and one of the girls hollered, oh, you see, we came here to work. There is the food we're gonna feed the animals. And I'm looking up, and I see a small window, like a glass pane, which pictured all our naked heads, our shaved heads. And I looked up, and I couldn't find myself. And I went like this and this, and then that's how I found which monkey was I, because we all looked like monkeys. And then the crying came again. And then finally a woman came out of the barrack and said, now, my name is Edith, and I'm your block supervisor. and she was in charge of us. And she had about 10 or 12 Stummendienst, that she called, helpers. And she says, if you don't do what you have to do, they can beat you up too. And they did. We come in to the door, to the gate, they let us in five at a time again. And I look in and I saw the huge bunk beds, five decks, and that long big ones so that five people could had room to lay there, to sleep on it. It was dirty, it was hard. They gave us a blanket, and they said, "I'm going to go lay down." We didn't want to eat. A few minutes later, they bring in that garbage can, and they say, "Now line up for food." Nobody wanted it. We were hungry, but the first night, nobody touched that food. Then, you don't eat, then go to sleep. Who could sleep? So nobody told us what to do, but yet every one of us jumped up off of the bed and were running toward the gate without any coaching or anything. And when we came out to the gate, the Bürgermeister came out, the block supervisor, and says, "Where do you think you're going?" And he says, "We want to see our family." And she says, "You can't. And what are you complaining about? I was here already for 4 years building this for you. And you were at home eating by the fireplace, eating the goose livers." So, and she was hating us for that we really came later. So they chased us back to the bed, and a few minutes later we were all there again, more determined that we're not going to let them push us back. And then she comes out, "So, you want to see your family?" We said, "Yes." And we thought that she's going to now take us to our families. She opened the gate. I noticed it was dark outside, but the sky was a vivid red. And I looked up and it scared me, and I didn't know where it came from. It was just red, and the stench, the smell of burning flesh. Now that was strange to me too, but it was horrible. It made you sick. And then she says, "You want to see your family? There they are burning." And she said that, we believed her. We started to cry. We didn't know how it happened, but we believed her that our families are gone. And then we went back to bed, and we cried. I cried all night. I didn't even know I get so many tears, but I was just crying and crying, and it was just coming. And didn't solve anything. But the next morning at 4 o'clock, they woke us up, even if we fell asleep. And we had to go on Zähler, which we lined up, and they counted us. They counted us if somebody didn't disappear during the night. And they came out sometimes with the wrong total. And we had to stand there, and they were counting us 3-4 times again until each time it came out the right amount of us, right number for us. And then they said, "Okay, now you go to the latrines." And we went to see what's the latrines. You guys know what a latrine is? I didn't. It's a big trench.
A trench.
And on top of it, there were built a bench, and you sit on it and eliminate it, and had to be very careful not to lose your balance. So you get off, you were looking for paper, you were looking for water, there was nothing there. So you went back and they were serving you coffee. Some black water. I never drank coffee, so I didn't know even know how it should have tasted, but it didn't taste like coffee. But it was hot and we drank it and it and then twice a day we didn't have too much to do there because we just came in and they didn't prepare any work for us at the first couple of days. But they gave us some buckets of some white powder. It says that it was to disinfect. And we had to spread all over the place. And it was choking us. We didn't know what to expect. Now we know that our people are dead. It's my sister and I, we were crying a lot. There was no place to wash. There was no place to take something to eat. In the evening, they gave us a slice of bread and some soup, watery soup. And that's how our life went for the next weeks. And they put us next to a mound of small rocks, and they gave us some baby toys like hammers. And they said, break these rocks into powder. Those rocks couldn't break with those little hammers. They jumped up. You know, hit us in the face, hit somebody else in the face, but we couldn't do nothing with it. So that's just to show us that we can't do anything, that to degrade us. They expected us to do something that was impossible, and then we didn't get nowhere, so that's it. The intimidation went on. The German shepherds came to count us with their SS people. And we were scared, and we were just going on one day after the other, and nothing could solve our problems, nothing could help us, nobody could help us. If we said something, we were beaten up. I got so many beatings over my head that when I came home, for years I had the big headaches, sometimes even now. How much time? No more? All right, then I will just stop. I have to tell you, I didn't speak about it for a long time, and somehow it's not easy, because I relive everything I say, and it makes me shake. So next time I'll be better. Thank you for listening, and I hope that the anger and the hate that those Germans had will not be in your lives, or if it comes, if you're angry, if you want to hate somebody or something, talk to somebody, talk it out. Or if you see some group is attacking some person because he's black or he's brown or he's purple or whatever, help him. Look at it and say, that shouldn't be. Don't say that, well, it's not my problem, it's not my thing, and I walk away. No, call somebody, call the police, and after that make sure if there is ambulance needed, call them. And just make sure that you remember the perpetrators, the ones that were attacking those people. And that's the only way you're gonna stop the hatred and the anger, and it's up to you, and you can do it. And thank you very much for listening. I wasn't very fluent today.
I'm going to take questions. We'd like to have you ask questions. I know that both Lillian and Lucille find that to be an important part of what they do. Any questions? Yeah.
Well, we were able to read about what Lucille felt when you went back, and I was wondering, Lillian, if you've been back and if you felt the same level of continued sort of apathy and anti-Semitism from.
Have you been back, Lillian?
Pardon?
Have you gone back?
to home?
Yes, once. And I wouldn't go back again. It's not home anymore. And like somebody asked me before, could you forgive or forget what they did to you? Well, that's a question that, you know, younger people were asking me, and I had to tell them, I didn't forget, and I can't forgive them for murdering my father so brutally in front of me, but I'm not going to live with it. I let go, and I'm not hating them. I'm not angry anymore. It happened, and it hurts, and I miss my family, and I just hope that everybody's aware of what can become of hatred, prejudice, intolerance, and it's not going to happen again, but it's happening even today.
Yes, Lauren. More privilege?
Yeah.
She's hoping. She wants to know whether after the war there was any distinction between Polish Jews and German Jews. Was there a hierarchy that you could address?
Yes. There was in New York when I arrived in New York in 1946. There is even today. If you look at Temple Emmanuel in San Francisco, somebody suggested that I come for the annual memorial, which is in April. It was a few years ago. And they said, we don't want a Polish Jew, we want a German Jew. It still exists, believe me.
The whole issue of intra-group prejudice.
It is stupid, but it exists.
Yes?
It seems in your book that many of the German officers and SS officers that you ran into after your experience essentially denied any involvement or any wrongdoing. Did you run into any former military personnel or oppressors that felt sorry for what they had done and asked forgiveness?
Nobody has ever apologized or expressed regret. I received in 1947 a letter from one SS man, and he said, you promised me a house if I let you escape. I'm willing to collect now. I should have saved the letter. I put it in the ashtray and I put a match to it. He didn't let me escape, but he wanted the house in 1947. There even is not today, at the 60th anniversary in Bergen-Belsen, a real apology from high up in the German government. Sometimes something is said, but a real apology there isn't. And we wouldn't forgive. There is not enough money in the world to repair the damage they have done. I've told them, if you give me back what you took away, which is my family, we can talk about conciliation, but not before.
Yes, Tanya?
I'm not a political scientist. My son is. I'm not. I will be in Israel on the 2nd of March. I can tell you a great many things about American politics, the good and the bad. But I can't address Israel. I don't live there.
I was wondering, when did you guys learn English? When you were young? Or
I learned English in second grade.
I learned English in America.
Whether any, the question is whether they, either one of our guests, identify with their homelands. No.
No.
I came home after the war, after the death march, and I went to my house because I felt that my mother will be coming home. I created a fantasy like this. And I go with my sister to my house, and they would not, because mother wasn't home, wasn't there. My sister knocked on the door, on our front door, and wouldn't open. Somebody hollered, "Go away, this is not your home anymore, it's my house." Somebody was living there and wouldn't even let us in. So, you know, what do I have there?
Yes.
I wonder if Lillian would address the question that was asked about Israel and Palestine.
Okay, yeah.
The gentleman would like to know whether you will address the question that was asked about Israel
I didn't
and
hear
Palestine.
The question, hmm? I didn't hear the question.
Did you have thoughts about what was about the difficulties in Israel and in Palestine today? You wanted to share.
I don't understand.
The question is whether you would like to address the difficulties that are happening between the Israelis and the Palestinians.
Well, I'm not a politician, but I feel for Israel because I feel for the people. And the Palestinians, I feel for the Palestinians too. But now, the way they go about it, I don't know if anything will be accomplished much. Because even the election happened there, and it was done democratically, but it's not a democratic situation there. There is no democracy there. And it's too bad, because they could live so nicely together and help each other. I don't know anything.
Yes.
Survived is because you were working?
The question was, do you think you survived because you were working?
No. I was working, but I didn't survive because of that. I survived because God wanted me to, and I created for myself something to live for. Many times I felt that I would be better off just to jump against the fence, which would burn me up immediately. But I created a fantasy that my mom is waiting there for, will be waiting for us. And that gave me strength to go on and come home and get, and find nothing.
Lucille, would you like to address
that? I survived because of friends. When I have typhus, a friend brought me water. A friend shared a turnip with me. A friend took me off a transport that never returned, that never had a destination. I survived because of friends.
Yes. The question is whether, if you had the opportunity to face one of your oppressors, first, could you identify someone who you might want to confront, and whether you could think of something you might want to say to them?
I did 60 years ago in a court of law, in a British court of law. They sat in front of me. I identified them. I gave a deposition. I was threatened, and I left Germany. Now they're not alive anymore. But I did identify 42 of them.
I did not recognize the faces.
You wouldn't recognize the faces.
I would, like immediately. Immediately.
Bonnie.
What were your thoughts of God when you were in the ants in the ghetto?
What were your thoughts of God?
At one time, when I got beaten up on Yom Kippur because we were trying to keep Yom Kippur at work, and a couple found out about it because we had the quota together at work, and she beat me up, and a few other girls beat me up on the head terribly, that I didn't think, what did I did wrong? What was I doing wrong? We were skinny like just skin and bone. And yet, we asked our supervisor to keep our bread and give it to us in the evening. And we were fasting on Yom Kippur. And then I got all this beating. And then my faith was kind of fluctuating. But when I, as I came, I was always with God, and I was raised religiously. We had an Orthodox home, but I never did it home. In my adulthood, I never had a kosher home or anything, because I believe in God, and God is walking with me, and I always feel that I'm helped by God. With all the tragedies I had, I still believe in God. And I have faith now, and I'm a fairly religious person.
You might want to come up and take a look at Lillian's display, and she's got an article that was printed about her in the Press Democrat when she had her bat mitzvah, or her religious confirmation, just 2 years ago, right?
2 years ago, and I was 8 years old.
Yeah. Lucille, would you like to respond?
I was brought up Orthodox, and I spent more than 4 years in concentration camps. And I can quote you, Elie Wiesel. I've seen many hangings, especially one in the ghetto, which happened on the street in which I was housed. And Elie Wiesel, when he witnessed his hanging, said, "There hangs God." I'm not religious.
My question was along the same lines. Do you guys come out of the camp practicing Judaism still, or did you feel strong enough to persuade your sons or daughters to get a bar mitzvah or to practice Judaism, or was it just left up to them?
Did you encourage your children to have religious education?
Well, to my regret, I didn't enough when they were young. Because that time I was working, and I was working for a survival, and religion didn't come in until later. But yes, they were both bar mitzvahed, and they were sent to Hebrew school. But today, my son is married to a non-Jewish girl, a nice, beautiful Russian girl. And they're very happy, and I'm happy with them too. They have beautiful two grandchildren.
Lucia?
My kids were raised liberally Jewish. If you ask them what they are, they would tell you, "I'm Jewish." Their friends are not restricted to Jewish people only. Their friends encompass any religion, any color. It doesn't matter. And it wouldn't matter to me.
How difficult was it to come to a completely new country where you had no family, your culture was in a sense just kind of stripped away from you after going through everything? How did you make yourself part of this country? Do you know what I'm saying?
I came to New York in '46. I was 21 years old. I knew a few classmates from way back, but nobody asked about the past. Nobody wanted to know. It was an embarrassment. When I met my husband, his distant family, cousins, aunt, and uncles, said, we don't need a girl from the camps, and we don't need a Polish Jew. I've never forgiven that. There was no social worker. There was no psychiatric care. There was nothing. My father had a friend from home, way back, who was a psychiatrist in New York. He found me and he said, come into the office. I did go for maybe half a year, and he wanted to hear about the past. And then he said, how can I help you? I said, I don't know. I work in a factory. I haven't finished my education. I don't know how you can help me. He said, well, when you find out, let me know. And that was the last time I saw him. So I had to do it more or less by myself. I have a very good family. I had a very good husband. I have two very good sons. And that helped. But we are all damaged. It's just a matter of degree. It doesn't seem obvious when you look at us, but there is damage. And there are people now 80, 90 years old who seek psychiatric care in Berkeley. They never had any help. And that I find very, very sad.
When did you come to America?
The British. Go ahead.
I came in 1949. I was 24 years old at the time. And I came with my husband and a 2 years old little boy. And we settled in California. My brother was here and my sister. And We made a new life here. Learned English and worked. It wasn't easy, but like everybody else's start, isn't it? You know, that's how we started.
Cassie?
Did many people renounce their religion while they were in camps?
The question was whether people renounced their religion, you mean? Demonstrably and said, you know,
I know there were records of who was Jewish and who was not, but did anybody try and sort of get out of it by saying, no, I'm not Jewish, or they've done this to me, where is God now? And
some people tried, and if they could pull off a story like that, there was a Jewish woman from Warsaw who succeeded. But she had a lot of trouble with the Polish forced labor people that worked with her. They somehow knew, they somehow sensed, and they didn't buy her story. But it was easier to survive that way than in a camp. No. In fact, civilians in Poland hid a great many Jews, more Jews than any other country, more than France or Holland or Belgium. Sometimes they did it because they were decent human beings. Maybe not literate, but decent. Some did it for money, for jewelry. I have a distant cousin who was hidden year after year, and she had a lot of jewelry, and she got rid of it, and that's how she survived. Kumirski, who wrote The Painted Bird, which is not autobiographical, it's just a story. His family survived because they had a great deal of money before the war, and they had it with them in the form of gold and coins, and somebody was hiding them. So there were various ways of surviving. There were people who changed their religion. Take the Archbishop of Paris. His cousin is Arno Lustiger, the historian. He was hidden during the war. His father was in Auschwitz. His mother perished. He was hidden by Catholics. He became a Catholic. He's the Archbishop of Paris. Everything is possible.
I'm ready for one last question. Who has it? Yes. The question was, did survivors work together to help each other after the camps were opened, shall we say?
Everybody went his or her own way. The camps existed from 1945 to 1952 under better conditions. But if you could get away legally or otherwise, or as a bride of an English soldier or the Palestinian Brigade, you took that avenue. And some left Europe legally, and some had to wait that long, 1952, to leave Europe. And a great many stayed. And my question to them last year was, how can a Jew of my age, or even younger, live in Germany? And the answer was economics.
Well, I found that we lived together, we helped each other, but...
You went home after you were liberated.
Yeah, I was home.
You went back to Czechoslovakia.
I went home, I went to my home first, to Czechoslovakia, where I was born, and then I went to the Sudetenland because that part of Czechoslovakia was taken over by the Russians and they were closing the borders, and I didn't want to remain in Russia because I know that the Iron Curtains are, once they're down, then they will not come up. And so we escaped and we went to the Sudetenland where we lived after the war until 1949. And then my brother brought me out to America.
You'll learn later in the semester about the displaced persons camps after the war. There were so many people, Jews, mm-hmm. but other people who were also forced laborers who had been taken to Germany from their countries, and people were kept in camps. And everybody didn't automatically go, oh, I get to go home now.
Well, some people came home and then they went back to the to Germany because there were these DP camps set up by the Americans. And from there, gradually they could go someplace. They could go Israel, they could go America, they could go someplace. Some went to Venezuela, wherever they could get out. But some people, like myself, I didn't want to go to the DP camp. I didn't want to voluntarily go to Germany to another camp. And I was fighting that. And so I didn't come to America until 1949. Because by then the quota was very, I came to a quota and visa. And by then the quota was very long. 2460 or 68 or something was my number. And we had to wait for 3 years for that.
We had to wait 3 years. Would you join me in thanking both Lillian and Anne? Thank you. you would like to sign the book. I invite you to come down and look at pictures of Lillian's family. And if you look real hard, that picture should be familiar. You saw it in the